Praise to your Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, two friends were talking. One was telling the other, "My life has not been the same ever since the accident." So the other friend asked him, "What is this accident?" He said, "That only, the day I put my finger in the wedding ring." And so we need some smiles at this time. We need to have a little joy in our life, because this is something that we have missed for some time. I'm sure every priest has been telling you about what we are going through, and I'm mentioning the same. We have had a roller coaster of a year. We started off with great hope, with great joy, with great promise, and suddenly the COVID, and we've been put in a situation we are really uncomfortable with, something that we have never seen in our lifetime. We are filled with distress, uneasiness, anxiety. There are lots of people now calling priests and counselors because they are depressed. They don't know what to do. There's a lot of depression that has affected people today. Therefore, for some of us, our hopes, our plans are kept on hold, and we don't know when this will vanish, when we can start planning easily, openly for the future. Que sera, sera, whatever will be, will be. The future's not ours to see. And today is such an important day for us, because today is the present. It's a gift for us. God has given us a special gift today, and that is what I want you to be aware of. Be in the now. The past is mystery. The past is history. The future is mystery. Today is the present, and it is a gift given to us. And today when we honor Mary, we know the dryness that we are experiencing, the lack of joy sometimes in our life, the inability to do the things that we do, move around as we would, the inability to come to church as a community. And even if we do, there is a lack of enthusiasm, the signs of cracks and division. So what is there that we look forward to? When we look above, we look at our leaders, whether it is our political, whether it's our religious, there doesn't seem to be much hope and strength given to us from them. We are lacking something, and we are looking forward for something, and that is what we are given today. If you say, "I suffered so much during this COVID," if you say that there is a dryness, there is a slowly, sometimes when we live together, we are staying together, and for many days together, there's a kind of uneasiness. There's a dryness. We don't know what to do. We have played all the games possible. We have seen TV, reruns, Netflix, and everything possible we have seen. And we suddenly have to face each other, and there's a dryness. There's a slowly ebb of our love for each other. We want to tell you one thing, that Mary too at this, she suffered heartbreak, she suffered pain, she seen a son unjustly given up to suffer and die. A heart must have broken, it surely did. But the same heart that was broken was given hope and redemption, like all of us. Because through this death and suffering of Jesus, people were brought to salvation. They were brought to God. They came closer to God more than ever. So the suffering and pain, instead of being something that is negative, something that is depressing, became something so uplifting and redemptive. And that is for all of us, as we also must have gone through difficulties in our life. Some of us are getting back our hope. Some of us are getting back to our lives. But there is something that is in us. The fact that we cannot come together, that the fact that we are so disconnected today, brings a little disease, this ease or uneasiness, a little suffering in all of us. When we are separated, there is suffering. But we are assured that Mary also went through this, and she is offering us a chance through this suffering to open up to love. Suffering is a chance for us to have a new beginning, to have a new meaning to our lives. Suffering is an opening to love, the surrender to God, to feel His embrace around us. So it depends how we see this. Like there was a fair, what we call a fete. In that fete there was a man dancing for joy, jumping around, everyone was noticing him, like there's no tomorrow, dancing, you know, teen mark. And as he was dancing, he seen his friend coming in front of him, very sad. He said, "What are you so sad for? Come on, let's have some fun." He says, "No, 2 hours back, in this big crowd, I lost my wife. I couldn't find her. That's why I'm sad." "But why are you so happy?" he said. "Why are you dancing so much?" He says, "2 hours back, I too lost my wife. I can't find her now. I'm dancing." Yeah? This is how we can see suffering. One person sad, one person very happy. So when there is suffering, we have the chance to open ourselves to God's immense love and embrace. Because that is how He is there for us. The death of Jesus, this excruciating moment, this darkest moment in the life of humanity, in the history of humanity, became a moment of great joy in the resurrection. And that is the hope we all share. So firstly, if we have found dryness in our life, if we are suffering, if we have gone through a difficult moment in our life, remember, you can open yourselves to the immense love God can embrace you with. It is the love that Jesus gives us in Mary and through a powerful intercession and help. And that is the second point I want to make, is that Mary is there for us. We can't go to Mary this time. We can't go to Mama Mary today. We have booked our tickets to Velankani. We can't even go to Kartabad. Hello? We can't even go to Our Lady Shrine Velankani in Alaguda. All of us are sitting in front of our TVs or on our mobiles or our different devices, and we are following this Mass. But one thing you be assured, this year you can't come to Mary, but Mary is coming to you. And that's the first thing that Mama Mary did when she was told by the angel that she will be the Mother of God. She didn't wait for all her neighbors to come. She didn't want to be like a celebrity. Everybody is taking out pictures, different newspapers coming, different TV channels coming, somebody coming to take a video of her and then put it on YouTube to say how famous she is. She did something so simple. She went across hill country to her cousin Elizabeth and was there for her need. Nothing could stop Mary. She traveled for days, she had to travel, and there she visited her cousin Elizabeth and was there to help her in her time of need. And that is why she is today Mary, Help of Christians. While we are there disconnected, so separated, Mary is with us even more powerfully when they were together. Because when we were together, we were distracted. Who is coming to church? Which father is saying Mass? Who is dressed up like this? Who is, you know, yeah, going to target father? Who is going to say something outside the church? What are we going to get for snacks after Mass? Distraction. So this is a nice time for us today to be focused, concentrated on Mama Mary. Because she has come across hill country. She has come across, despite COVID, despite what is happening, lockdowns everywhere, she has come across everything, every barrier she has crossed to be with you in your home, to embrace you, give you that warmest embrace, to strengthen you. That is why she has that so much of power to be Mary, Help of Christians, and our powerful intercessor. She is there for us to tell us that there is hope. We are people with hope because of Mary, because God speaks more powerful in persons than in words. There are so many messages we have been listening to. There are so many beautiful videos we are seeing. There are lovely masses we are attending. The words that are flying out from people are giving us hope. Fantastic. But hope is greatest when it is found in persons. And Mary tells us, she didn't give big sermons. Her last words were, in the Bible is today's gospel, do whatever he tells you. That is the spirituality of Mary. Whatever Jesus tells you, do. That is our spirituality. That is what she left us. And he's telling us that there is no more powerful message that God has given us than in persons. God loved the world that he gave us his only son, that whoever believes in him will find salvation and be redeemed. So let us turn to Mary, seeking not just her powerful intercession and help, but more so her eternal place in our life and in the life of the church. Having said that, we come to today's gospel, and I just want to make one point of the gospel. Firstly, we see that this gospel passage is not found in other synoptic gospels, in Matthew, Mark, or Luke. It is only found in the Gospel of St. John. Simple, because St. John was the beloved of Jesus, the disciple whom Jesus loved. But not all, that's only. He was also close to Mary. He loved her as his mother, because on the cross, Jesus said, son, this is your mother. Mother, this is your son. He took Mary as his mother from that day onwards. So he was one of the closest with Mary, to Mary and Jesus. That's why he has a better perspective of Mary and her life in the church and her standing in the church today and in the community. He's seen what Mary did. He's seen Mary giving, nurturing the early church. She didn't desert them. She didn't leave them, say, my son did so much and he was given up to die such a horrible death. She didn't say that. She continued to be with the disciples. She continued to nurture the early church. She continued to give them hope and fill them with graces through her intercession and her presence. So John has a better perspective because he even lived the longest among the disciples. So today he's making one point and saying that Mary is important in our life. She has contributed to the growth of the church, and we can benefit or have a great benefit because of the greater insight and privilege of Mary that is given to us. He is given to us in the gospel today. At the first time, it was given importance by John because there's something very special in his first miracle, which he calls the sign at Cana in Galilee. It not only underlines what Mary did on that day, it also tells us of her permanent role in the economy of salvation. She did one small thing there, concern for the people, saving them from embarrassment. But that small act of love and service she did has a permanent impact on the economy of salvation and for all time to come upon the church. Mary is the eternal nudger. She is Mary, the saint of the elbow, meaning she is always nudging Jesus to move forward, to do something for people. For people she is concerned for. Look at these people, so disconnected. Look at these people, so locked down. Do something for them. And then she'll tell all the angels and saints in heaven. And she tells us, as the disciples of Jesus, do whatever he tells you. So there was a wedding at Cana, and the mother of Jesus was there. Such a beautiful thing. There's a wedding of Cana every day in our homes today because the mother of Jesus is there. She is there to help us. She is there to intercede for us. She is there in heaven. If you ask the question, what are all those people doing in heaven? All those who have died, we offer masses for them. We want them to reach the highest peaks of heaven. We keep offering. I've seen so many intentions. Fantastic. You have not forgotten your loved ones. But what do they do when they go to heaven? What are they doing there, morning to evening? They're only doing one thing, and that is interceding for us, praying for all of us. And there, at the top of that pyramid of prayer, is Jesus himself, intercessor. As we hear in the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 7, verses 24 to 25, Jesus lives forever, and he is there. His work as a priest does not pass on to someone else. He is our eternal priest, bringing us to God through his prayers. And because he lives forever, he pleads with God for them and for us. So there on top of that pyramid is Jesus. And who is there beside him praying for us? Is our Mama Mary. She is there also right on top, because she's always concerned for us. Like the wedding of Cana, so today she's telling her son, and with the intercession of all the angels and saints, and Jesus at the top, she's telling, please do something for your people. Please do something for your children. When there is anxiety, when there is despair, when there is pain in the life, when there is a diminishing of love, when there is a brokenness in relationship, heal them, comfort them, strengthen them. That is what our Mama is telling us, telling Jesus and all the saints in heaven. So their focus is always on us. She has changed her location, but not her occupation. She is always interceding for us, like any mother, always concerned. Now mothers are like that. Where are you going? Why are you going with them? Why are you going at this part of the night? Are you sure you're going to the right point of friends? Always concerned for us. May not be the right questions, but the bottom line is the mother's always concerned. And what more, Mary? God has given us the best of all mothers. She is truly a mother incarnate. Trust her. God gave her the best. She has not gone to heaven and taken the ladder with her. She wants all of us to join her. And that is the beautiful picture we should have, that we are journeying in life in faith with Mary accompanying us. We may wear blue, we may wear all kind of colors, but remember, the power of Mary and intercession is always beside us. She is there urging us on, passionately concerned for us, always trying to save us. She took her, she assumed into heaven, body and soul, and she took her elbow with her, because there she is nudging once again Jesus, telling her, telling him, look after your children, look after my children, take care of your brothers and sisters. They are in need of you more than ever before. So believe in her concern for you. Believe that today in your family, Mary is powerfully present. And when you pray together, ask Mary's protection. She will not let you down. Amen.